done. In the smaller format, US format books, we'll probably go right back to the start of the US series. So you'll start with issue one, through to however many fit in each collection, and throughout the year. The UK collections will continue also. We have lined up Legacy of Unicron for January, which will also collect little bits like the Headhunt story and at least a couple of others around that main story arc.
Will the
Robo Gamers
comics be collected
in
some form or another?
I don't think there's no plans at the moment. No plans at the moment, I'm afraid.
Since Marvel has been...
A question in the back here.
Hello, Mr. Furman. I've been wanting to ask this question since last year. I kind of missed it. But I read a play called RUR by Carol Capek. Rosin's Universal Robots, and it's a question that probably nobody else is interested in. But there's a character in the, it's like the first play in which robots are mentioned. And there's a character in that play named Primus. He's like the first robot to attain humanity. And I was wondering if Primus from RUR is where you got the name for the Transformer God.
It's honestly not. Primus just seemed, you know, Primus, the beginning, you know, Primes. That's all it came from. It wasn't sort of taken from anything. It just has that sort of the beginning type feel to it.
Mr. Furman.
Where are we?
Over here.
Are there any more plans to put any more of the collections out in a hardcover edition?
All the US format collections will have a following Diamond exclusive hardback. Dark Designs, which comes out, I think, in September in paperback. October, the hardback will be a cover by John Byrne, who's done sort of everything from Superman to X-Men to Fantastic Four. He's done a really nice job. We haven't got an artist yet for Rage in Heaven, which is the second half of the Gen 2 collection. But we are talking to a number of name artists about that. So, yeah, there will always be a corresponding hardback. But we're not at the moment doing hardbacks for the UK collections. There is a hardback of Target 2006, which is being issued through the Transforce convention. Sorry, shouldn't mention that here, but just so you know. But, you know, we may well end up going back and doing Diamond hardbacks of those later, Dave.
Any stories from your days on Alpha Flight, the world's only Canadian superhero team?
Do you mean, are there more to come?
No, but any stories from your days working on it at Marvel?
I'll answer this one and then we'll roll into the panel itself. Alpha Flight was, sort of a lot of fun to work on, but it was a kind of strange thing just because I was, you know, not neither an American or Canadian to write in, but, you know, I muddled my way through with it and, you know, had a lot of fun with it because it was kind of the nearest I got to writing an X-Men book.
The Dreamwave team!
Guys, do we want to start by just introducing ourselves?
Yeah, sure.
Hi, I'm Chris Sarracini. I'm currently writing the G1 series and the Armada series as well.
I am the production manager, and I try to make our books come out on time.
I'm Pat Lee Pessler of GU1 and co-owner of Dreamwave Productions.
I'm Adam Fortier, and I get to do the boring business stuff.
Simon Furman, a sort of hanger-on with the Dreamwave crew. do you want to just throw this straight open to questions?
Well, I don't know. I'd like to thank everybody for having us. We're having a great time. This is our first BotCon, and it's been really fun. We didn't know what to expect, and it's just been a blast. We've been having a great few days. So thanks for the support. Thanks for having us. It's been awesome.
Rob
my brother and I, when we were like 10, 11 years old, we were producing Transformers, a comic book when we were young, and I'd like to thank everyone for the support that they've had for Dreamwave Productions and the future and our present, what we've accomplished, and we appreciate everyone here. Thank you very much.
This being my first panel, I'm assuming that people just stand up, ask questions. Okay, let's go.
You raise your hand, we'll run you with a microphone, and
be nice,
the floor is yours.
Yeah, please be nice. Be gentle.
Are there any plans to do anything with another G1 comic book?
We in November, when you get the G1 trade paperback, you will actually see a preview of the next G1 comic book. We plan to do probably about 1 6-issue G1 comic book series a year, not including obviously Simon's War Within, specifically aiming at the continuity of the original G1 series. We'll have 6 issues a year just based on that story.
Since you have Simon, does that mean that Death's Head could possibly show up?
I wish it were so, but Death's Head is a Marvel character. It would be lovely to do so, but maybe someday.
I was wondering if, since The War Within is going to be a sort of a fill-in-the-blanks type of story and give us information we haven't had before, is there a chance we could have a miniseries that would cover the time period between G1 and Beast Wars?
We want to take this license and use it in order to flesh out and look at the history of the Transformers. That means Beast Wars, Beast Machines, RID, G1, G2, Armada. We don't want to focus on just one area, I think that was a concern going in, that we would only do Generation 1 and maybe touch on a couple of other things. I can tell you right now that there are plans to do a Beast Wars limited series. There are plans. Pat's a big fan of RID, so we plan to be bringing that in at some point in time. We're not really taking this opportunity, so just to let you know, to flesh everything out in between. We want to take individual stories within, so I can definitely see how that would be something that might be very cool to do in the future, but for now, if we do a Beast Wars, we want it just to be about Beast Wars. Do you know what I mean? We want it to be a story that's good on its own and that doesn't need Generation 1 as, a helper for it. So I think there's tons of good stories out there, and you just gotta hit them all.
I got a question for Chris. How much is Hasbro keeping you in a certain story arc line, and do they keep you in saying that it has to be a certain amount like the show or with the show or kind of parallel to it? Or I noticed that now you're kind of in a different time with the same characters that Armada's going to be dealing with. How much is Hasbro?
Well, with the Generation 1 series, they've been quite flexible in allowing us to explore things, allowing me to explore things. One thing that we've struggled with is the level of violence, especially with the G1 series. We're trying to give it a bit of an adult edge, but at the same time, we recognize that in the end, it is a kid's property, a kid's franchise, so we can't go too far. But despite that, Hasbro's been very good in letting us try new things. Now, with regards to Armada, of course, there's certain plot points that you have to hit if you're going to make this a representation of what they're trying to do with the television show and the toy line. There are certain mandatory things that you've got to get to. What I tried to do with the first 2 issues of Armada is explore some of the backstory that doesn't get explored, that the TV show doesn't explore. So with the first 2 issues, I'm trying to provide that backstory, give that little bit of extra information, make the comic unique in that sense. So if you're looking for that history, you'll find it in the comic book.
Hi there, my name is Sejan. Two comments, actually. Simon, just want to thank you. Your writing is absolutely brilliant. And Pat, Derek, just want to say thank you for making the hometown boys proud. All right. Cheers. Best of luck.
My question is for Chris. With the Transformers personalities and characters, it's very important to the fans. And you have a lot of weight on your shoulders to recreate the G1 and everything, and then create anew for Armada. Really, my question is, as far as Demolisher goes, are you planning on characterizing him as a pirate?
No comment.
All right, good afternoon, guys. As a fellow comic book artist and writer, I'm always interested in learning how other people have gotten the start in their career. So you always have a story of how exactly you all got into doing comics and how you got to the point to where you are now.
I started when I was approximately 17 years old, 17 or 18 years old, and I got my first job at Extreme Studios at Image Central, one of the studios which was Rob Liefeld. And I had a lot of training there. I was offered a job, and my portfolio was looked at by Dan Fraga and Stephen Platt. And it took approximately 2 years for me to actually, when I first started my portfolio, it took me 2 years after in order for me to get my first gig. It was very difficult. I had to go to a lot of conventions. I had a lot of editors look at my portfolio and said that I was never going to make it in comics. And it was very hard, and I almost gave up. I had one last convention to go to, and literally that was the one where Dan Fraga and Steve Platt looked at my stuff and sent my stuff over to Rob Liefeld, and from there my career started. So it was a lot of fun while doing it, but at the same time it's very tough to have a lot of editors like look at your stuff and say you suck or you're not good or your anatomy is all wrong, and you just got to be content with your own work and make sure that you're doing it because you love it, and don't let anyone push you down. You have to keep striving for it and keep pushing it and believe in yourself that you can make it.
I was doing some schooling. I was going through teacher's college in Toronto. I live in Toronto. And so I'm a high school teacher, so if anybody gets out of hand, I'm going to throw you in detention. But I was doing a lot of writing on the side. And one particular project, I teamed up with an artist, Sigmund Torre, who was doing some work for Dreamwave already. And we sort of tag-teamed with the intention of hopefully, talking to Pat about maybe publishing this particular story through Dreamwave. Now that story, unfortunately, Dreamwave didn't have room on the roster for that, but Pat was pretty impressed with my writing. He brought me on to help, to help in sort of a developmental capacity where I was developing stories for them. And then he blessed me with the Dark Minds job, Dark Minds Macropolis, which is the current series that I'm writing. We're about midway through that. Pick it up if you don't have it. Cheap plug, but I'll pay you. Pat, I just sort of, in doing more and more work for Dreamwave, Pat was more and more impressed with my writing, more and more confident in my writing. And then one day he came to me and said, I think we're gonna go with Transformers, I want you to write it with me. And I said, all right. And things have gone from there. I mean, it's been both simultaneously a stressful experience and a really great experience. I'm having the most fun with this book, so I hope everybody enjoys it. That's sort of my story. Things have gone from there.
For me, it was definitely a case of, I got my foot in the door editorially before I ever wrote. I was working for IPC Magazines, who published 2000 AD at the time. Got my first writing gig there, and then went to work editorially at Marvel UK, and again, sort of worked from the inside out, which, if you're looking to be a writer, it's a good way in.
Next question.
I just want to say, again, thank you so much for coming. Breaking with my usual yearly question about asking for a Neonice limited series, one-shot, or backup story, I would like to know what you said to Hasbro to get them to give you the license, because it sat there and languished for years after the end of G2. I know the artwork and the presentation was a big part, but what did you do to convince them to say, hey, let's do something with property that makes us a ton of money?
You want me to take that one? It was perfect timing all around. I mean, they were going to launch Transformers Armada, so they definitely wanted something, wanted to do something with the license. We kind of came in at the right time, and I think the exact same thing that we said was, you know, Pat Lee will pencil it if you give it to us. Made it pretty easy, actually. It really was a matter of looking at G.I. Joe, and G.I. Joe had been very successful for them in the beginning. And they said, hell, why not do this with Transformers as well? Perfect timing.
I had a couple questions. I want to know, number one, in terms of art design, a lot of the character models in the G1 series seem to be a real interesting fusion between both the show models and the toy models. I want to know if you had any maybe insights or explanations on that. And I also want to know how the heck you guys managed to snag Simon there and how you managed to get up with him. And I guess my last stupid fanboy question, if Daniel's around, where's Carly?
She's at her mother-in-law's. No, she might pop up soon. You never know.
In terms of the design question, what I did was I took a lot of the designs for the actual toy and I mixed it with the cartoon. And I had some of, you know, the original designs by Takara. And I really welded all three of them together because a lot of people had asked me, oh, which one are you going to use? And, you know, like, personally, you know, I've always had, there's certain elements from each individual design of the particular robot, let's say Optimus Prime, you know, with the longer antennas, with the shorter antennas, and I really chose the things that I enjoy drawing the most, and I welded those together. Ironhide is a toy. Didn't feel that that would be the best thing for the comic book in terms of designing the toy. But the animation, you know, is just great in terms of, you know, personality, brings character to the face, and I really wanted to show a lot of characteristics in all the characters. And I just welded all of them together to, you know, to come up with designs.
And as for how we met Simon, I don't even fully remember. One of us sent the other person an email.
Well, I shamelessly assaulted Pat with emails.
It has to be said, you know, I just want to see Simon blush, you know, that we really didn't look at it as he is the Transformers writer, so we need to get Simon Furman. We looked at it as Simon's a great writer and has been in the industry for many years, and he would compliment us on no matter what we did. I mean, to that extent, he's even going to be writing a, as yet untitled, Dreamwave project that is not Transformers related because he is that good writer.
In the comic that's coming, that, well, just finished coming out now, the Gen 1 comic, it appears to have been set in, like, the Gen 1 comic universe, because both of them, you know, Spike and his brother were in it, or, well, were mentioned. And I was just wondering, because, you know, there are different, you talk about you're going to be doing Gen 1 stuff, and there's like Gen 1 cartoon, Gen 1 US comic, Gen 1 UK comic, and each one is kind of a little bit different. And I was, you know, wondering, are you going to be doing some that are obviously tailored towards the cartoon, some that are obviously tailored towards the comic, and stuff like that?
Well, I think our philosophy with regards to this topic is what we're trying to do is, our objective is to welcome back the trans fans that read the original comic book, that watched the original television show, but also reintroduce this franchise to people who might not know, who've been in a cave for the past 20 years and don't know who the Transformers are. And we recognize that not everybody knows Transformers, not everybody is familiar with the history. So what we're trying to do is take pieces of the various continuities and create a blend that makes them work as best we can within each one, and makes it really clear to new readers, and welcomes them as well. And I think so far we've been successful. I mean, and you know, we're just trying to keep that up. That's the goal. We're not trying to aim for just the hardcore fans. We're not trying to make this so dumbed down that if you have complete knowledge of Transformers, you're going to be bored. It's kind of a trying to find the middle ground, the middle road.
I got a quick question real quick. I was just wondering if you guys could tell us anything about, I think it's called Sandscape, when you guys are coming out this fall. I know it's not Transformers related, but it looked pretty slick. So I just want to know if you guys can tell us anything about that.
Just to let you know, all of our books are slick. All right. Give you a very quick overview, and you know, to let you know as well, we have the preview book on sale at our place. Shameless plug for a dollar.
For $1.
One American dollar, and it has a four-page story from five of our properties. Sandscape really isn't the only property that's coming out. We have Warland, we have The War Within, obviously. We have Fate of the Blade.
I remembered that, yeah.
Written by Mr. Chris Sarracini.
What else do we have?
Warland 23, we already said that.
Limbo City.
Yes. And Arcanium. There you go. So, just to let you know, those are all new titles. Sandscape, set in a world where there are deserts. There are cool cities in those deserts. There are gigantic mech robots beating the crap out of each other. And people, too. So, there, so, that's basically what it is.
Cool. Actually, if you want to know more, look up our second print of issue 2, G1. There's an interview about Sandscape in there. It tells you everything that we know about it right now.
That's what I heard about.
Okay.
Yeah, we don't want to give anything
all
away.
We know.
You know. Yeah, we're still making it up ourselves.
Dreamwave's not all about, you know, producing a Japanese anime style comic book. We want to produce, you know, anything that's cool looking, anything that has a great storyline to it. You know, we used to be, you know, we started out as a Japanese anime company, but you know, we're open to any, you know, ideas and stuff like that. And, you know, as long as we have some interesting concepts, you know, visually it doesn't really matter to us whether it's a Japanese style or it's an American style. We will produce whatever that looks cool.
So that doesn't give you a lot, but I'm sorry, there's not a lot to give right now.
Hello. I was wondering if you're going to be doing any more team-ups with Devil's Doing for G.I. Joe crossovers?
Mm-hmm. That's definitely being talked about. That's kind of one of the ones that pops up the most, you know, do a Transformers G.I. Joe crossover. I think we've said the only way that we'll do it is if it's just like one page and it's like, you know, Devastator just stepping on all of G.I. Joe. That might have been a bit mean, but you know what I mean. When we did this comic book, you know, when we did this comic book, we wanted to make it a bit more, I'd say, realistic. You know, you had these robots running around that looked like they might have been 7-8 feet transformed into trucks. You know, we're still definitely going huge, but, you know, the concept behind Devastator was he was freaking big, right? He was, like, mean. It was cool. And to do a crossover with G.I. Joe, it's a bunch of humans running around with guns. What are they going to do to the Transformers? You know what I mean? That's what I got with the four-part miniseries. It's all they could do was kill Bumblebee.
G.I. Joe, then.
I wanted to do that, but they wouldn't let me.
Oh, please, God.
So it might happen. We'll confirm nor deny anything, but you're right. That's probably the most obvious crossover with the Transformers. So.
I just wanted to know the chain of events that happened to have you guys land the Wizard World Big 80s article. Did Wizard contact you, or did you already have a license to draw it? Or?
I think it was James McDonald of Wizard Magazine, who's a great guy, and he's, you know, we love James, and James loves us, and...
Not in that way.
Nothing's wrong. But, he just came up to me and asked me if I was interested in doing, you know, an 80s property, and I said, what do you have online? And he's like, well, we were thinking of, you know, since you like to draw mechs,
you know, robots, and then why don't you try drawing Transformers? And I was like, that sounds pretty cool.
So just to break in for a second, I think what you're talking about is the first piece that you did for Wizard.
Okay.
What they're talking about is the 80s properties article. Dreamwave did almost a year before we actually got the Transformers license.
Oh,
we did a nice splash page for Wizard magazine, and that's really where the whole thing got started. It was Cybertron with the Autobots and Decepticons flying. That's where the whole thing started. They called us up, said we'd love you to do a Transformers piece, and we said cool. Then a lot of other people saw us and said, well, why don't these guys do the license? And it kind of snowballed from there. The 80s property article, we already had the license for that. And it was with the success of G.I. Joe, with the, hopefully, success of Transformers, which it was a success. And we know that they had a couple of other licenses, Battle of the Planets, Masters of the Universe, and so it made sense to do an 80s article. And that's where we got you. You can clap.
How you doing? I just had a quick question for Mr. Furman. I was wondering if you could give us a little more insight into the upcoming War Within series.
The idea with the War Within was, I mean, everybody knows, it's a bit like the Star Wars prequels. Everybody knows how it's going to kind of end this. So the fun with the War Within was just getting inside the characters a little more and showing them before they're the characters we know. And that very much includes Optimus Prime, who is going to be quite radically different to when he starts off to what he ends up as. I really just wanted to show that these characters weren't heroes from the word go. They weren't sort of suddenly cut from this dynamic cloth. You know, they had to get there through effort and trials and, you know, sort of personal struggles. So a lot of the War Within is going to show the characters going through these loops, these initial loops in the war. You know, you've got to remember with the Autobots is that they weren't a warlike cat race, but somehow they learned to fight, somehow they organized themselves. And a lot of the War Within is just showing how the politics, if you like, shifted and moved within the Autobots to make them what they are. So it really is a kind of, you know, getting into the guts of why the Decepticons are Decepticons, why the Autobots are Autobots. And, you know, the guys in the middle, the guys who won't fight, you know, we meet some characters who really want nothing to do with the war. So, you know, it's just looking at Cybertron, it's looking at the politics, the internal workings, and, you know, a heck of a lot of action as well.
Hi there. First of all, I have to say, I'm sure everyone feels the same way, how happy we are that there's another Transformers series coming out with the comics. My question is that I know in the current, you know, what's already been released as far as comics, cartoons, and whatnot, there's not very many female characters. Do you plan to change that with this comic?
Is that another main question? I mean, I think a lot of it will depend on how flexible Hasbro is in allowing us to design characters. Because, you know, if they're not, then what we're stuck with is whatever characters were given to use. If we had our way, I don't see why we wouldn't explore that. There's a lot of female comic book readers out there that I think would appreciate seeing something like that. So, you know, if we have our way, then we'll see what we can do.
What I'd like to know is, what kind of links will there be between the Armada comic and the Armada cartoon, if any? Will they be, like, related? Will they be feeding off each other? Or will they be separate storylines entirely?
Yeah, like, it's sort of tied to a question that I answered earlier, where there are key plot points that you must hit. You know, the three kids will appear in the Armada comic. We will eventually get to Earth. What I want to do with the Armada series, comic book series, is explore some of the territory that isn't given enough time in the cartoon. You know, my interpretation of the characters might be a little different from what you see in the cartoon. The mini-cons in the cartoon are sort of, they talk in beeps and sounds. That's not the case in the Armada comic book. So there's going to be some differences. But at the same time, there's a loose structure that we have to remain within.
Really big little guys.
It's, there's definitely that. We kind of looked at it and said, Megatron can transform into a gun. Why can't Devastator get really big? It's not fun when you have, these incredibly small toys that combine to form a toy that's slightly larger than Optimus. It really doesn't give you an idea of the immensity that really should be there with a character like Devastator. So we just wanted to make him big, big and alien. So, yeah, we made him huge because it was fun.
Why did you decide to make Grimlock a Decepticon now, and can we see that in the future with other characters jumping sides?
You're gonna have to read the last two to see how it plays out. Will other characters be jumping around? It's an idea that I really like. It's one of the things that I really wanted to do with this particular series and future series. I want to toy with these characters, and one comment that has been made about G1 quite frequently is that it seems very gray. There's no more black and white, good guy, bad guy, morality. There's a lot of gray areas, and I think if we're going to make this comic book a little bit more mature, then that has to hold up. So I can see a lot of that happening in the future.
And a lot of the war within will also fall into that category, because like I say, these guys weren't born one thing or the other, or created one thing or the other. So we're going to look at these sort of shades of grey and, sort of choosing sides, really.
I would be very interested in hearing more about this upcoming series that's supposed to be kind of like a spotlight guide to the Transformers, like a modern-day equivalent of the old TFU series. We've been told it will feature something like 300 of the Transformers within it.
371. 371, we counted.
What I wanted to ask was, are those all going to be G1 characters, and what can we expect in terms of the profiles for them? Will these be like the text or the tech specs or the old TFU text, or if it's new material, who's writing it and based on what?
It's, to break it down, in the month of November, a 96-page book will be coming out, TF Profiles, number 1-4. November, December, January, February, each month, a 96-page book will come out, and that will combine for the whole of Generation 1. That's it. Trying to add up exactly how many Transformers are out there with Generation 1 and Generation 2, Beast Wars, Beast Machines, RID, Armada, and everything else you can think about, we just realized we'd have to do the equivalent of a trade paperback a month for a year and a half. It's not very realistic for us. So we wanted to focus on the fun one, Generation 1. And so I can tell you we're going to have new art for every single one of the characters. It's not going to be art that you've seen before. We decided to go absolutely nut bar with this one. And you're going to get to see... Wait for the end. You're going to get to see them in robot form and them in vehicle form. So, because we didn't want to just focus on the robots or just focus on the vehicles, so you have both of those. They're all going to be new profiles that are being written. We had to think really hard about that, and the best thing for this is it's an opportunity for us to kind of define the characters more, and through the characters actually define the world that they come in, that they come from. The biggest problem, as I'm certain that you guys know, is the comic book, the cartoon, the toys, none of them follow a specific continuity, that can be linked into the other without, a lot of tweaking. And, you kind of sit there going, who are these characters? Which ones do they represent? And there's always been lots of talk on, is it a comic book? Is it a cartoon? What is it? It's ours. That's how we're making it ours. We're basically rewriting the whole thing and saying, these are our characters, these are where our characters come from, without having to tell you guys, go out and watch season number one, or anything like that. So, but most elements will be taken from the cartoon, the comic book, and everything like that. You're not going to suddenly come out and find out that the character's totally changed from what you expected. And that's about it. So we actually want to do this with most of the worlds. We think that it would be fun to eventually have just kind of a big, thick book just with everything, And so that's kind of like an ultimate goal, but we'll see how long it takes us to get there.
Right.
Nobody in specific. No specific writers, no specific artists. It's going to be a mishmash. We actually originally wanted Pat to do all the images, but he said
I got a quick question on some of the Generation 1 characters that you never saw in either the cartoon or the comic book. Especially if you were talking about flip-flopping sides and working with that with some of the characters. One of my favorite ones of all time was the Double Spy. You could use that character in so many different ways, and it really hasn't been explored that much except for a brief cameo in the Headmaster series on the cartoon. Is there, not to mention with some of these new characters like Blaster's Cassettes, my favorite of all time, Roadbuster, the Jump Starters who, transform into Cybertronian vehicles, is there any possibility where you could create your own continuity since there's really been no character development from some of those in these upcoming new miniseries next year and the year after, where you would see those characters play a significant role? Because even some of them you made some great artwork on, like one side you would see Soundwave and all his cassettes, and then you'd see Blaster and his, but you never saw like any great wars between, those. I was just curious about that.
Well, I mean, I definitely think that we're going to try to get to as many characters and explore as many characters as we can, and the ones that we find interesting. And just listening to the list that you've described, a lot of the characters that you find interesting, we do as well. Are we able to touch everybody with this first arc? No, it's not realistic. But that's why we have long-term plans, long-term goals. So, with the length of our time on Transformers, we hope will be very long. So if you have patience, we're going to try to get to as many as we can.
Yeah, quick question. Since Devastator seems to be super popular in this panel right now, I bought the calendar for Armada. There's a Constructicon-like vehicle towards the end of it. Can you make any comments on that? Who that is? Because he looked huge.
Armada calendar?
Yeah.
Armada.
I don't know what the internet is. Hi. First of all, I just want to say War Within Grimlock rocks the universe. He looks even more badass than T-Rex Grimlock, to be honest. And basically, that's what I just want to say. And to the Dreamwave guys, I want to know, you're doing G1 and Armada, and which one do you find more challenging to write and draw? Just because with G1, obviously you have all this history that you don't really want to necessarily trample on too much, and Armada, you have this whole new universe that could pretty much take almost anywhere. So I just want to know which one do you find you get the most satisfaction out of doing?
I get the most satisfaction from Generation 1, and it is simultaneously the most difficult. It's exactly like you say, Armada, there is more room to breathe. I have the ability to sort of shape the characters a little bit more. Not that I'm not trying to do that with Generation 1, because there are many Transformer writers before me. I mean, the greatest is right on this panel here. And, but what I'm trying to do is bring a unique shape to these characters that is distinctly mine. So, that's what's difficult. I'm trying not to step on what has been done before, but at the same time bring a little Sarracini-isms to them, you know what I mean? So it makes for a more difficult write, but at the end, it's definitely more fulfilling.
Artistically, it's really hard to say. Generation 1 has a lot of detail, but there's a lot of elements in it that make the character who he is, and in terms of design. Armada is also difficult because it's very, very intricate, the design work of Takara. And we, personally, I try to make, get as close as I can to, as precise as I can to the original designs of Takara. And, both ends have, they're both difficult and they're both just as enjoyable as well. But, it's just, I think personally, I like working on the G1 stuff. And as difficult as it is, I enjoy it. So I don't, time flies. I work like 20 hours a day, and I don't even, see the sun really, because I'm stuck in the office all day. But it's, you know, I don't find it really, this is really our hobby. It's not even really our, you know, like a job to me, so it's great.
I'd just like to say also, my artist on the wall within has had the thankless task of having to retrofit every Transformers character that features in it, but he's done it magnificently. You wait till you see what he's done with some of these characters. It's just amazing. And not just that, he's made them so they all work. You know, sort of they transform and they work. They still look like the characters. They are Cybertronian modes, but somehow they all fit together. And we've even got this, the Constructicons are there, Devastator is there, but he makes it all work somehow. He's just done an amazing job.
Don is extremely an incredible artist. He, you know, in a matter of 3 weeks, he turned out like all the designs for the War Within. And I mean, he's so quick, so it will be on time. And he's just an awesome artist. And you know, it's very exciting to have him on board. And we're all very excited to actually color his work. And you know, it's just a great team, the War Within. And we're very, very excited to have this on board and to kind of recreate some of the, you know, the history of Transformers.
Follow-up question for the Transformers profile project. Will that include the quotes and the statistics, strength, firepower, from the text packs?
No.
Okay.
It's too tough to hunt everything down, so.
All right, hi. This question's for Simon Furman. Now, if The War Within, you know, becomes like a really, really huge hit, which it most likely will, because it looks amazing, do you think there's any way that you guys at Dreamwave could get Hasbro to make these guys into toys? Because you say that you got the artists to actually make it work, so, I mean, could you get these plans to Hasbro and make them make it work?
Well, I mean, personally, I'd love to see it happen. You know, I mean, whether it will or not, you know, these are decisions for Hasbro, but, I mean, the designs are just so good. I mean, I can't see anybody not looking at these designs and thinking, wow, so, you know, I'd love to see it happen.
The one thing that I think that we should point out is, though, that Don isn't a toy designer. You know, he's an artist, and so we say that they'd work, but I have no idea. I don't make the toys, so, you know, I'd be careful with that. I have no idea if they'd actually work or not.
Hey, guys. My question was, on those Japanese re-releases, how did it come up that your artwork got published on the packaging? Did Takara?
From what I know, Takara was very interested in you know, using those images, and they pretty much, they didn't really have you know, a new image to put on, so they, you know, they pretty much decided to put it on the box. And you know, it's an honor to work with, you know, a Japanese company that caliber, and for them to be able to put my artwork, you know, on the box. And it's great to, you know, to do work and see it on the box, so I can, you know, show my children. So thank you.
Yeah, I have a question about the issue number 6, and not a plot question or anything, but as G1 series progressed, it started off on this, like, the pacing has been, like, started off in this low level, and it's been stepping up every issue, and now it's, like, reaching a crescendo, and you got, like, 2 more issues to do a whole, what seems to be a whole lot of stuff. So I'm wondering if issue number 6 will be, like, I don't know, a 48-page issue or something like that.
If Chris had
if
it,
I had my way,
it.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. The, it. I don't know how to answer this question. I'd love it for it to be that size. That's just not the formatting that we've got planned, unfortunately. But I don't think anyone's going to be disappointed with the finale. That's for sure.
Hey, I got another question for you guys. Now, as you guys get hit mostly with Transformers questions, I wanted to throw some others out at you. First of all, I think you guys were interested in getting the He-Man property, but you didn't. I was wondering if you did, what you guys were planning to do with that. The other one is, I think I heard that Adam was a big fan of Mask. And as Mask is owned, that's right, as Mask is owned by Kenner, which is now owned by Hasbro, even though I hear Hasbro doesn't want to do anything with Mask anymore, I was wondering what the chances of you guys getting any sort of influence and doing anything with Mask. And the third one is, like that guy was saying back there, if you guys could bring Punch and Counterpunch into it, that would be wicked sweet, because that guy was wicked cool, and he had no screen time whatsoever, and he made an awesome Transformer for the book.
Bring Counterpunch!
Right.
Well, okay, to answer the first question for the He-Man license, you know, from what I understand, they own the He-Man license. Did we have a look at it? Yes, you know. I think it was just kind of a group decision in the end not to grab it. Basically, we are not a Marvel, we are not a DC. We have basically a prerequisite number of books that we can't put out a month. And we want to make sure that if we're going to do one of those books, we're going to love it, we're going to cherish it, and we're going to be able to do the best damn job on the face of the planet. We thought that way with Transformers. Turns out we were right. It's a property like He-Man, you know, you have to have the right team, and you have to have the right, you know, emotional investment in the property. You have to love it dearly, and it just wasn't there for us. It's a great thing. We played with it as children, but it wasn't there. I mean, for Mask, I'm probably the only one here who likes that. So there we go. It's, but would we like to play with other properties? Potentially, but you know, Mask, I don't see as being like a monthly series. You know, like maybe do a couple of fun one shots, and that's about it. That's kind of what I see in those areas. You want to make very sure that you don't suddenly bring back 80s properties just because you know you'll sell a bunch of them. And there was punch, counterpunch. Yes, sorry, that was the third question. The real reason why he's actually not in the comic book right now is because, you know, you have to pay him royalties, and he's just asking far too much. He will never be in there. We have to pay him twice.
Hello. I know Genesis is still in the planning stage. Is that book where you're going to include all of the lost Takara art and things of that nature? So please, please include that War Within character models of the Cybertronian forms. Oh, please. I'd love to see that in there.
Well, there's actually going to be a War Within preview book coming out before the end of August. It's going to be 24 pages. It's going to have an extra 6-page additional story with the 4-page preview, plus it's going to show a bunch of the character up. So
oh, that's awesome. Thank you. And my question is a toy-accurate Jetfire representation possible? Or is that still legally not an option because of Bandai doing their reissue Macross 155 upgrades?
There's a whole bunch of, you know, legal issues with basically every single toy, every single character. That's probably one of the most sensitive ones. Personally, I really don't know what it would take in order to do a Jetfire. We all love Jetfire here. We all think he's really cool. But by the same token, you don't want to make a lot of waves. So, I don't know. I hope that we will at one point in time be able to do something with it, but that one there's no guarantees on.
Okay, on issue 3, that big red dome, I'm sorry I stepped in plenty, we covered what exactly has happened with it, and the characters were up on the wall.
Sorry, what was the question earlier? This way in the back.
Back in issue 3, you had the dome that Soundwave and Megatron had set up, and you had characters chained to the wall.
Yep.
Are those characters done with from what exactly is that red dome?
We can't say.
Well, I mean, the more you read of G1, the more you'll understand the nature of that dome contraption and how those transformers that were on the wall are connected to it. So, read up, and it'll be there.
My question is not really a Transformers question, but it's a comic book artist question. So I guess it's really more for Pat Lee. If a person wants to become a comic book artist, what kind of day-to-day sort of job do you have? Do you like go in the morning, draw up until lunchtime, eat your lunch, draw up until dinner?
I don't have lunch.
So you can tell a little bit about it.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Me personally, it's really tough. I mean, when I was younger, when I was a freelancer for Wildstorm and Extreme Studios, and you know, doing some stuff for Marvel, it was a lot more simple because I was a freelancer. You know, it usually takes approximately anywhere between six to 10 hours to do a page. I was called a machine at Extreme Studios because I could probably do a half a comic book in one day. And that's not producing the highest quality of art, but, you know, it's an investment to a company to hire someone who can be that fast. Now I don't have any weekends really off. I work, like anywhere between 15 to 18 hours a day, whether that's artwork or whether that's paperwork or whether that's emailing. It's a very hard job, you know, and to be able to be on time with your comic book it's very demanding and it's a very tough industry. All artists will always want to put their best effort into it. As much time as I do have on Transformers, I put 115% into every single hour that I work on those pages. And I hope, everyone sees that. It's very tough, and I wish that I could put even more energy into the pages, but it's still very, very tough. The average day is usually, your layout, you do your layouts and thumbnails. That usually takes anywhere between 20 minutes to 25 minutes. And it gets blown up into a 11 by 17, and you pretty much lightboard it. You pretty much outline it on top of 11 by 17 board with a blue line or with a Rainbow Blue pencil or a regular pencil. And you pretty much just start etching out and refining the details of each individual page. And the average artist usually takes around 6 to 8 hours per page for penciling. Oh, and the borders are very important. They take a very long time.
I just wanted to ask, what was the original Jetfire conception? Was it the toy one or the cartoon version? Mm-hmm. If any of you knew that. I guess that's a confusing question, but what I wanted to know is which came first, as far as the idea was Skyfire / Jetfire.
I believe it was the toy, from what I understand, and if I am wrong, maybe somebody can correct me. I believe the toy came first, and then they put him in the cartoon.
Yeah. And I guess my next question attached to that is, was there ever a mold design for the toy for the television version of Skyfire?
That would probably be a Hasbro question. And not a
I figured that.
We don't have access to any of that information. So, sorry, can't help you there.
And I wanted to tell you, you're welcome. You guys are doing a great job with the offer.
I was wondering, in relation to the Beast Wars comic that you apparently are going to make one, if it's going to have anything to do with what I thought was an ingenious use of the Golden Disc storyline, if we'll see any characters that weren't actually in the show, and if it'll be before the Transmetal Devastation junk happened.
Unfortunately, I wish I could flesh it out more for you, but I can't. We want to do a Beast Wars comic book. Beyond that, we haven't really sat down and said specifically what story arc we'll aim at, what characters we'll be in. That's a job for the writer, and I wouldn't take that away from him. So.
We can't hear you.
See Don in some of the other books. There's no reason not to use him. He's a great artist. So you'll see lots of Don. It's just a 6-issue limited series of War Within, and then we're moving on from there.
Hi, question on the Beast Wars. The cartoon, The Beast Machines Battle for the Sparks, and left some open-ended questions. do you have any thoughts on exploring the organic roots, the underlying layers of Cybertron that they portray in the cartoon?
Again, that's pretty much a question for the writer, and you know, it's, we don't know any of that stuff right now. I can tell you that, you know, we are not specifically doing these comic books to, you know, answer outstanding questions in the cartoon series, in the toys, whatever, because to do that is to aim it at a very small audience. We want to make sure that when we produce a Beast Wars comic book, anybody can pick it up and enjoy it. You know, you don't have to have specific knowledge of existing characters, existing storylines. And if we can do something to answer the outstanding questions while still making it accessible for everybody, that's what we'll go for.
When you guys first announced that you did the deal with Hasbro for the licensing, there was a comic element, which we've talked a lot about here today, but there was also an element of merchandising. Can you tell us more about what you guys are going to be doing with that in the future?
We have the rights to do posters, lithographs, calendars, and wall scrolls. You can buy the posters and calendars from us right after this, where we'll be signing as well, by the way. I don't think anybody really anticipated exactly how well the posters would do. We have 8 posters out now that they sell as well as all the other posters. There is no drop-off, so are we going to create more? We're going to keep on creating the posters and keep on making them really cool. You'll find in November, we actually have announced the posters for the incentive cover and the hollow foil cover, because we have a lot of people bugging us for that. And we're going to work on creating new art for that. You'll probably see posters on non-G1 characters in the future. So, for calendars, one every year. That's the plan.
I have a question. In future issues, War Within, Armada, will we be seeing any appearances by Orion Pax or Vector Sigma or Alpha Trion?
9 feet.
To me, that all speaks of a very specific continuity, and this goes back to what we were saying about not sort of pegging it down and saying this is where we're drawing our inspiration from. I just think that makes it a little too specific. So I think those kind of characters that, you know, only ever existed, say, in the cartoon series, probably won't feature.
Yes, I'd like to say congratulations on being number one for the past 4 months.
Thank you. Yes.
What I wanted to ask was, do you plan on having any of the, other artists that used to do the Transformers on any other series? Like, say, Andy Wilder, Manny Gallen, Jeff Senior? Or is it just that you want to stay the core for the company now, before you get bigger than what you even are now?
For the most part, for Transformers, we like to keep it in-house. We don't, you know, we live in Toronto, Canada, and, you know, we ink, we color, Pat obviously pencils, same with James, in the studio at all times, and it just helps us control quality, the style, everything like that, and that's our preference. We have not specifically spoken to those artists, but they're great artists on their own, so there's no reason why we wouldn't use them at all. But you'd have to ask them if they'd ever work with us. Not the other. These characters are from Takara, and so we'd actually have to set something up separately. We don't get the right to use the Japanese characters, so it might be kind of hard.
I have a question concerning G1. Is that basically filling the gap between the end of season 2 and the movie?
Yeah, it fits in there. But again, we're not trying to make it so that it connects only to the cartoon and movie, the visual stuff. I mean, we're trying to bring in the comic book elements as well. But yeah, I did try to shoehorn it in there. It's one of the few dead zones that hadn't been explored when we started the series, so... it's something I wanted to get to.
I
I wanted to ask about the megalithograph. There's rumors as to what it is, but I want to know if you can say what it is and approximately how big is it.
It is. You want to come take this one. Take this one.
It's 5 feet by 3 feet, and if you take all your G1 issues, Descent Upon Pan and Out of Black Cover, you'll notice the interior poster, I'm sure. They all line up.
And so it has hundreds of characters in it. So there's some that we're going to miss, but you won't notice.
Wraps up the panel here, so if you guys have any closing words, thoughts, words of wisdom, or just words of smiling faces.
Oh, sorry, was that directed at us?
Oh, that's you guys.
Oh,
yeah, this
yeah.
is,
well, again, I mean, the thing that I'd just like to just say again is we really appreciate the support. We're a small company doing our best to pave the way, and you know, we wouldn't be the first independent company to hit number one if it wasn't for fans like you guys and you guys and you girls. So we really appreciate the support. Thanks again.
I've had the pleasure to work on Transformers as as a young child, It's awesome that that we have a place like BotCon come to and be able to collect our Transformers and to collect our parts, and it's just it's great being here for the very first time, and I thank everyone for collecting Transformers. Thank you.
I know that there have been a lot of questions regarding characters that we're going to be using, continuities and everything like that. What I'd have to say to that is we're going to be here for a long time. Don't stress out that you don't see something in the first 6 months. That's a promise, not a threat. Don't worry about it. But we plan to be doing this for a very long time. We love Transformers.
Good. Just on a personal note, it's really great to be sort of doing Transformers again at a current level. I've been here a few times to BotCon. It's always slightly been on the former glories, but this is the first one where it's kind of nice to have some new product out there, and I thank you all for picking it up.
Thank you very much, gentlemen.